the plan. Never deviate from plan. Vote it through.
Sorry. So I obviously failed the first test of this conference. I'd like to thank Richard and thank the organisers for inviting me to speak here today. Obviously, what I'm going to say are my own views and not those of the ECB or of the Eurosystem. Let me set the scene by just highlighting the importance of market-based finance. I think the President spoke to this in his opening remarks yesterday, and I think he actually spoke to some of the underlying data that's in the left-hand chart, which shows that by March 2018, the total share of the financial sector assets held outside the banking sector, so by non-banks, stood at around 55%. And what you see there is an rapid growth in the non-bank financial sector since the late 1990s across all segments. So our data quality has improved, but you see rapid growth in particular in the investment fund sector, but also elsewhere in the non-bank financial sector. What the right-hand chart focuses on is investment fund holdings of debt securities. So it's a rather specific dimension, but I think it's also useful to draw out that quite a lot of this financing is effectively supporting the real economy. So if you look at the right-hand bars in that right-hand chart, what you see is that a large share of non-financial corporate debt, so ultimately real economy financing, is held by investment funds, and that share has grown from approximately 15% to 20% in 2009 to around 30%, close to 30% now. Now, part of that reflects the role that investment funds, other non-banks, played, acting as a spare tire as the banking sector recovered after the crisis, but part of it is obviously structural as well. Now, as Richard has said, there's a lot of work that's been done on different dimensions of what is called shadow banking, what I'm going to call market-based finance, and a range of risks have been identified by really important and useful work by the ESRB shadow banking group, by the FSB group that also works in the similar space, by the work of authorities like EIOPA and ESMA, obviously work that's done here, and by other national authorities, national central banks, national supervisors, and so on. And maybe just before I go on to the main theme of my talk, it's just useful to recap some of the risks that these reports have highlighted in the non-bank financial sector into three broad categories: interconnectedness, liquidity, and solvency and leverage. Very briefly, on the interconnectedness side, these institutions, these intermediaries are very highly connected or can be very highly connected with the banking sector on both the asset and the liability side. There are also common asset holdings that might be common to, for example, banks, insurance companies, and investment funds. But perhaps one thing that's a bit less recognized is that there are also ownership links. So quite a large proportion of asset managers are effectively owned by either banks or insurance companies, which can pose a reputational risk if the asset managers that are owned by banks get into distress. Liquidity risk has been talked about a lot. Obviously, there's redemption risk at funds. Insurance companies run significant maturity mismatch, which exposes them to interest rate risk. And all of these dimensions can lead to amplification of market liquidity shocks. And obviously, leverage can amplify all of these risks, whether that's actual leverage or synthetic leverage. What I want to focus on today is that I think there's less emphasis on the interplay between market-based finance and the wider credit cycle and the real economy. And this was also a point that I think Philip Lane made in his keynote remarks yesterday. So what I'm going to spend the next 10, 12 minutes covering are three areas in which I see interplays between market-based finance and the credit cycle. So firstly, the supply of wholesale funding from non-banks to the banking sector. Second, direct financing of the real economy. And third, the interplay with terms and conditions in wholesale markets. There are, I should emphasize, also links to the wider debate here on the global financial cycle, but I'm not going to cover those in the interests of time. Then for illustrative purposes, I'm going to just cover very briefly two pieces of ECB research, which I think are illustrative of the type of work we need to do at the micro level to better understand procyclicality in the non-bank financial system. And I'll conclude with some policy thoughts and open issues. So let's start with wholesale funding. What this chart shows is based on UK data, and it shows the growth of debt in the UK from the late 1980s until 2011. Now, when you talk commonly about debt in the UK, or generally, there's a lot of discussion about before the crisis, a growth in household debt and corporate debt, which did increase to some extent. But what's quite striking is that between 2003 and 2007, two-thirds of the growth of debt in the UK was the growth of financial corporate debt, so the green stuff in this chart, largely reflective of intra-financial system activity, and a lot of that reflecting the financing of the banking sector by non-bank financial institutions. And it's quite remarkable in terms of the growth in debt. You also see a very sharp cyclicality, which this is a more granular focus on repo market activity, this time in the left-hand chart taking US data and the right-hand chart euro area data. And what you see is cycles in repo financing in the US and in the euro area. Again, the idea here is that the non-bank financial sector, through its financing of the banking sector, is essentially, or was prior to the last crisis, contributing to pro-cyclicality in the banking sector and ultimately creating wider systemic risks. Because that's one key dimension, the non-bank financing of the banking sector, which also obviously leads to interconnections. Second dimension, just direct financing. So what this chart, a very interesting chart from a recent FSB report, shows in red is the non-bank credit cycle. So the blue is the bank credit cycle based on a cross-country sample. You see very clear cycles in bank credit. What's striking is that in the most recent upswing, so the pre-crisis upswing, so in the early 2000s, the red, the non-banks, was very highly correlated with the blue. So you see non-bank credit cycles moving in sync with credit cycles, and you see that also during the crisis. Now, you don't see that throughout history, and I think this is a very interesting chart to prompt us to think why this relationship might change over time. But what is evident is that non-banks can also play a clear role in the wider credit cycle through direct financing, which is roughly what the red line in this chart reflects. Let me take a specific example of that, which again Philip Lane referred to yesterday. He mentioned real estate financing from non-banks. And what this chart shows here is zooming in on the insurance sector, specifically within the euro area. What you see here is in some countries, insurance companies have gained real estate exposure either directly or indirectly through funds. And you see that in the Netherlands, in Belgium, in Austria, in Cyprus, that the extent of these exposures are quite significant. And what I think is also quite striking is that in the three countries with the highest residential exposure, those are the ones in yellow, the Netherlands, Belgium, and Austria, they are also three countries that received a warning from the ESRB on residential real estate vulnerabilities in 2016. Now, there's not necessarily anything causal in that, but what it does suggest is that maybe insurance companies, when there's a real estate boom going on, might be an amplifier. We also have some information on, for example, commercial real estate bond holdings. And what you see in that sector is that investment funds and insurance companies are increasingly supporting commercial real estate lending as well. Last dimension is the terms and conditions of transactions in financial markets. And I'm thinking about margins and haircuts. And what you see here is a chart based on a particular hedge fund source, which shows that prior to the crisis, if you look at the blue line, there was a compression in the margins. Given the scale of what happens afterwards, it's not hugely evident, but margins compressed prior to the crisis. So essentially, the terms and conditions of wholesale transactions got looser. And then obviously you had a huge blowout in the crisis. But I think this is a really important dimension when thinking about, again, the interplays between non-banks and the credit cycle, because a lot of these terms and conditions are set by the condition by the way in which all of the different types of counterparties, which do include banks, obviously, but also a range of non-banks, interact in wholesale financial markets. And what you see, again, is clear evidence of pro-cyclicality in this dimension. Okay, so I said I wanted to show you a couple of examples of some ECB research which speaks to procyclicality. This is much more micro level, it's much more illustrative. And what I want to do, the first set of information is a bunch of aggregate macro type information. These two illustrative studies are just going to some of the types of behaviors that I think might be important for further work for the future. So in one way, you can think about this as setting up a future research agenda in this space. And these are some initial things that have been done by colleagues here. First one focuses on the investment funds sector, and in particular, the flow performance relationship and the interplay with leverage. So the flow performance relationship essentially says that when performance of funds is good, there are inflows. When performance is bad, there are outflows. That's well known. But what about the interplay with leverage? Obviously, there's already been discussion today, and there was yesterday, about leverage in the investment fund sector. The left-hand chart just sets the scene. I think, again, some of these figures were alluded to yesterday, where you see that there is some leverage, but not huge amounts of leverage in aggregate across the hedge fund sector based on an IOSCO survey. But what's quite striking from the right-hand chart, which is, again, illustrative because it's purely based on Dutch data, which is data that colleagues here worked with the DNB on this particular study, you see a tail of very highly leveraged hedge funds and bond funds. And it's this tail, I think, that we should be particularly worried about. So what did this study do? It took that Dutch hedge fund data over, the Dutch investment fund data over the past 10 years or so, and it looked at the flow performance relationship. And it looked at it in terms of positive performance and negative performance. So the left-hand chart shows after positive past returns, which you see on the x-axis, there were flows into both leveraged and unleveraged funds, which you see on the y-axis. So the flows on the y-axis are a percentage of the lagged assets, consistent with the theory, but no difference between leveraged and unleveraged funds. What is striking on the right-hand chart, when there were negative outturns for funds, so you see that again on the x-axis, you see a striking difference in the outflows from leveraged funds, which you see in yellow, from the unleveraged funds, which you see in blue. So essentially, the flow performance relationship was much stronger for leveraged funds. So an interplay here between leverage and procyclicality in the fund sector. Second thing I want to show is a study that's been looking at how insurers react to different types of shocks. And there's a theoretical model here which essentially explores the way in which changes if there's a fall in the risk-free rate, then insurers might act in a counter-cyclical manner. But the theory also works on the idea that if there's a decrease in the risk premium, the value of equity of insurers increase. So in those circumstances, insurers might act in a pro-cyclical manner. So that the way in which insurers respond to shocks might depend on the type of shock. So you can think of a boom as one in which risk premium fall, and that would predict pro-cyclical behavior on insurers. Obviously, in a low interest rate environment, that would predict more countercyclical behavior. So what this study did was looked at how the risk premium and the risk-free rates evolved and looked at when there were episodes of pro-cyclical behavior. And what you find is that while there's a lot of countercyclical behavior of insurance companies in the sample, there are episodes of pro-cyclical behavior which both encompass selling, which you see in the yellow, which is when the risk premium are rising, and buying, which is what you see in the grey bars, when risk premia are falling. So let me wrap up then with a couple of policy thoughts on where this all leaves us. I think the first thing to say, and I think the President said this, and I think it was picked up in the press this morning, is we need better data. And this has already been mentioned by Russ in his talk. And I think that is really key in this area. But let me touch on the three areas that I spoke to. On the wholesale funding dependence of banks, progress has been made internationally under Basel III through the establishment of the NSFR and the LCR. But one might also think about the need for time-varying liquidity ratios for banks or, for example, core funding ratios as have been used in New Zealand. Macroprudential instruments for banks, non-banks, however, are much less developed. And again, as the President said yesterday, this is a key area of focus and further work. Areas that I think are important would be to operationalise the macro prudential leverage limits for AIFs, which do exist under the AIF and under the relevant directive. Critically, developing globally comparable leverage measures for investment funds, which is essentially the FSB recommendation to IOSCO, which is essentially asking for better consistent measures of leverage, which again speaks to the data point. Now that's a really key part of the global debate. Operationalizing liquidity tools for AIFs, UCITS, additional macroprudential liquidity tools might also be useful. And then again, as was mentioned by the president yesterday, there's an ongoing debate about macroprudential instruments for insurers, which I think he mentioned was discussed at the general board yesterday morning, but AOPA have also published work in this space. Lastly, on terms and conditions in wholesale markets, I think it's important to impose, to have minimum margins and haircut floors on both centrally and non-centrally cleared derivatives and on SFTs. Now, the FSB has agreed to some of this in terms of SFTs, but the previous vice president also spoke about this in a much broader context. In addition, one could also think about time-varying countercyclical margins and haircuts as a layer on top of that. Again, I should say, in a lot of this space, the ESRB has done a lot of work, including publishing a paper, I think, in 2016 on macroprudential policy beyond the banking sector. So with that, since I'm, I think, a minute or two over, let me just leave on the last slide a bunch of open issues that I think are important, where we need to do further work on the interplays between the real economy, on procyclicality, leverage and liquidity risk, but critically on the toolkit for the non-bank financial sector. Thanks very much.